Hi, I'm Bob.
I'm Andrea.
And we are the Burnhams. We are missionaries with Mission to the World in Odessa, Ukraine. And Andrea and I were sitting around talking the other day, and we realized that while we've had the opportunity to visit many churches and talk with many of you about what it is that we do, a lot of you have not seen that. And maybe we haven't had an opportunity to come to your church or to talk with you personally about our ministry. So we thought we would put together the same kind of basic ministry overview in this video and show some of you who are interested in seeing. So thanks for being interested, for watching this. I hope you continue to watch through the end.
How long will it be?
You know, that's a good question. They could scan ahead, but basically it's going to be about a half an hour. So if you're willing to sit through the next half hour, you'll learn a lot about Ukraine, hopefully. I think most of you already know who we are. I'm from Pensacola, Florida.
Andrea, I'm from Littleton, Colorado, originally.
And we met back in 95 when we joined MTW in Ukraine. Mm-hmm. And we have three daughters. We have Abigail, we have Emily, and Iris. If you notice, they go in the order of the vowels. And we didn't plan it that way until Iris came along. We saw that there was a pattern there, so we thought we'd stick with that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it kind of helps.
So far, they're... vowel order also follows their height order, but that may be changing soon.
We also have a dog named Odessa. So that's the O, mm-hmm. A-E-I-O. That helps. If you're not aware of where Ukraine is, there's a map showing. We're basically sandwiched right between Russia and Europe. It's about the size of Texas. And when we first got there back in 95, there were about 58 million people in Ukraine. And the population has shrunk dramatically. It's around 45 million, I believe, now. I can double check that and I'll put a little note at the bottom. But a lot of reasons why the country has gotten smaller. You've got poor access to good health care. You've got a lower
birth rate.
You've got high abortion rate.
Yeah, with the poor health care, that means that older people are dying sooner. They're not living as long anymore. And a lot of people are seeking jobs out of the country. So we get to know a lot of people, yes, because the economy is so poor. They don't have the opportunities to make enough to provide for their families. And so good families that are in our churches, a lot of times the dad will leave and go and find work in Poland, Romania, or Slovakia, maybe going overseas, Canada, that kind of thing, or even working in Russia for summers, things like that, if they can get out.
A lot of you probably heard about Ukraine in the news lately because of the conflict with Russia, and that is one of the reasons, the biggest reason, actually, why the economy is doing so poorly right now, because of the fighting that's going on in the east. Not a whole lot of investment is going on right now in Ukraine. Mm-hmm. People are leaving to find better jobs. We'll talk more about it later, but there are about 2 million refugees that have fled from the east, from the fighting, and come into the rest of Ukraine. So it's taxing the system. We've lost Crimea. So there's a lot of reasons there. But it is a Ukraine, Kray, literally means in Ukrainian edge. Or border. Ukraine is the borderland between Russia and Europe, and right now I think Europe's pretty happy about that.
Yeah, and they're blocking some of the aggression that might be coming through from Russia.
Yeah. We started, like I said, back in 95 in a little town called Ismail.
We were not married at the time.
We were not
married. We didn't even know each other at the time.
And actually we weren't very interested in each other.
Nope.
For the first year at least. And we were part of a 10-person team called Commission, working with Mission to the World. And you see in that picture how Andrea's kind of leaning away? That's what she was doing. She was so focused on ministry. The second year, I started kind of leaning in, and she leaned away saying, no, we're all about ministry, which made me want to pursue her even more. And so...
it was counterproductive.
It was productive for me. So we returned to the States in 98 and got married. Mm-hmm.
97, yeah.
And then early in 98, we got married.
Bob worked as a director of recruiting for Mission to the World at that time, and I had finished up my degree in architecture, so I was starting to intern at a nearby architecture firm.
Yeah, and then a couple of years later, when we were in Atlanta working, I had the invitation to come back and work with the Odessa team. They needed a leader, a team leader for the church planting team. And our good friend Snezhana also came over from Ismail and said, we just need families to live there and to live a Christ-centered life and
alongside.
To reach out and
mm-hmm.
teach truth. So we returned in
2001.
2001 is mm-hmm. when we returned.
A long time ago.
Yeah.
So Ukraine has been in our heart for a very long time.
It has. 22 years this
mm-hmm.
summer.
Mm-hmm.
So Ukraine, when you look at Ukraine, you think about a couple of things. You think about, you know, those big furry hats that they wear. You think about Russia. Most people think Ukraine is Russia. It's not. In 2001, they became their own. No, 1991, I'm sorry. Mm-hmm. 1991, they became their own country. They are completely separate. It's like America and Canada. It's completely different. We don't live in Russia, but we do speak Russian.
Here in Odessa, our schools will be conducted in Ukrainian. The lessons will be done in Ukrainian, but the teachers all speak Russian with the students. So it's kind of a dual language area for us.
That's not to say that they don't have a lot in common with Russia.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at the churches, many of them, most
are
of them
Russian Orthodox.
Are Orthodox churches.
Mm-hmm.
And actually 84% of Ukrainians claim to be Christians. And you think, well, why are you there if 84% of the people claim to be Christians? Well, look at the breakdown. 69.2% is Orthodoxy. That's nearly 40% claiming Ukrainian Orthodox. That's the.
Those are separate from Russian Orthodox and Ukrainian Orthodox.
Right. Russian Orthodox, 29.4% claim to be Russian Orthodox, especially in the West. 14% call themselves Greek Catholic.
Mm-hmm.
And then Evangelical, less than 1%, 0.9%. And I think that's even a bit of a stretch to say that they are Evangelical, because many of those are steeped in works. Very few churches, I would say, as a whole, speak or teach grace and the true gospel of faith in Christ alone.
Mm-hmm.
In the Orthodox churches, there is a lot of beauty there, and there's a lot of truth there. But the
symbolism and reverence, the awe-inspiring cathedrals, everything that you would hope for people to understand more about God.
From what we've seen, though, most of the people that consider themselves Orthodox do not have an understanding of who Christ is and what it means to be saved by faith,
mm-hmm.
and even what Scripture teaches.
That may be because they're just casual attenders to church. They go on the holy days, the high days, or they go for sacraments, but they don't daily have that kind of relationship with God. They have more of a relationship with the priests and the traditions.
Do you get that? Okay. The average person, the average Orthodox believer, typically goes, they're very devout, and they will cross themselves very regularly when they pass a church. When they come into a church, they will often light a candle, kiss some icons, offer up a prayer, and then they
receive a blessing
on certain days,
mm-hmm.
and then they will leave. But in the average Orthodox church, there is no presentation of the gospel. There's no teaching.
And there's very little community, because people will stop in, they will stand in orderly rows, or they'll line up for certain blessings, but they don't necessarily get to know each other as well. It's much more of an independent kind of a situation there.
You know, the day that I see this the most exemplified is on Easter. We just celebrated Easter, and they did as well last Sunday.
Yeah, often they coincide with the Western Easter.
And what we typically see each year is that in droves, people will come to church with their baskets, and they have in their basket a lit candle and wine and Pascha bread, Passover bread, and some eggs. And they bring it to the Orthodox church, and they receive a blessing from the priest, and then they return home. And I've asked before people, you know, why do you do this? And they tell me, well, if you, well, first they say it's tradition. It's what we do every year. And I said, well, let's go deeper. Why? And they said, well, we believe that if you go there and you have your lit candle and you bring it home, you'll have good luck. You'll have more money that year. Not everyone believes that, but I'm surprised at how many people do, that it's more of a good luck thing. And it's just something you do as a culture. And it's a really difficult thing, because everywhere you go, you walk into the street, whether it's a cab driver or someone in a shop, you greet them on Easter with Christos Voskres.
Voistinu Voskres, they answer.
Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. And it's a beautiful proclamation of Christ and that he is risen. But when you ask them often about why the bread, why the wine in your basket, they don't know why.
They don't capture that symbolism with Christ being the light of the world, or the bread of life, or the wine, the covenant in his blood, that kind of thing. They don't see those connections. I'm not sure if it's just not been drawn for them, or if their ears have been closed to that. Obviously, that's the work of the Holy Spirit, and that's why we want to be there. We're not here to contradict orthodoxy so much as we're just hoping to deepen their understanding,
right,
biblically, of all that God has revealed through his scriptures and through these symbols, even, about his son, about his relationship with his people.
Because somehow there's a disconnect that they claim the name of Christ, but there's not the relationship there, and there's not the understanding of who he is. I'm the team leader for the Odessa church planting team, and that starts off with evangelism. When we first got to Ismail back in 95, there were no churches in that region, no Reformed churches especially. And so we had to start from scratch, and we did that just by getting out of the community. It's the same thing that happens in your own church plants in America. The only difference from America is that in America you have existing believers and you have a lot of transfer growth that comes in. In Ukraine, it's all first-generation believers. It's primarily new believers that come to faith. So it takes a little bit longer. I remember a long time ago hearing these evangelists saying, I went into Russia or Ukraine and we had camp meeting and people were coming to faith in droves. 1,000 people gave their lives to Christ. Well, maybe they did raise their hand, they acknowledged something like that, but that is not the same as giving your life to Christ and being transformed and living that life.
And it's not the same as church planting either, with what we're doing, with trying to be a follow-up to the evangelism, with discipleship, with mentoring, with relationships, and putting them in bodies, church bodies, so that they can serve together, so that in that community God can give accountability or, even discipline, whatever those people are needing as they come into community and serve together and know one another more deeply.
Right. So it takes a long time. It's all about relationships. It's all about getting to know people, mm-hmm. and showing them through your daily life what the gospel is, and helping them to understand, have a framework for that. Or 2 Corinthians 5:18, Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you, on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. And that's an important verse for us, because what we found is that often in a post-Soviet culture, there is a resistance to going out and taking the gospel of Christ to other people in your community. Under communism, you didn't trust people. You didn't broaden your circles.
You certainly didn't let people know what you were into or what you were really believing deep down in your core values.
And so I think there's this mentality of, we're a family, we're a church, we're safe. Why would we want to, and this is not everybody, but I think especially in the older generation, there's this thought of, why would I expand? Why would I want to mess this up? And
risk. And people's lives are messy anyway. Why do you want to open that up to your safe church congregation? So we've been trying to encourage our congregations, coming alongside them, trying to give them examples or even just giving ideas of how they can reach out into their communities in ways that allow them to be involved with those people more directly and still feel like they can go at their own pace.
Because a lot of times people see, we come over as Americans, we set up these outreaches, and people think, oh, evangelism is an outreach.
It's a program.
It's a big program. And what we want to explain to people is that it's not just a program. Primarily, it's God using you wherever you are, in your community, in your school, in your workplace, as you invest in people in your community and share Christ with them. That is what evangelism primarily is. It's you investing in loving someone else, sharing the love of Christ with them. So this is our church. This is a church that God gave us. It was built by missionaries, European missionaries back in the late 1800s. And when the Communist Party took over, they took control of this building and made it into many different things. Took down the cross, and they said, it's no longer a church, it's a government building. And about 15 years ago, some legislation passed, and they said, if you had any property that was unlawfully taken from you during communism, you can go to court and try to get that back. So our pastors went and said, we believe we're the spiritual heirs of this building. And they studied it, and they agreed, yes, it is. So they gave us this building.
The location is great, too, because it's right across from the main pedestrian walk in downtown Odessa. It's across from two city parks, one on one side and one kind of down to the south of it, on the way to the beach. And it's also very near to several universities. Even right there on that street further up are a couple of branches of those universities. So it's a great location centrally.
Mm-hmm. These are the locations of our other churches. We have 12 churches in our denomination. Now, the bulk of them are in the southern region where we live. And so a lot of my job is spent traveling back and forth to those different churches. We do what you would expect church planters to do. We teach, and when appropriate, we preach. Whether it's in a church or in a Bible study, there's obviously a lot of opportunities and seminars to teach people about the gospel. We provide leadership training. We have pastors that come over from America that help us to develop new leaders.
Much of that has been initiated lately by our national pastors. So that
George has been
George Kadan in the north of Odessa has really been hitting that up and sharing
the last several years
some of that with one of our guys in Lviv as well.
Clay Quarterman on our team has been seminary for years of the Evangelical Reform Seminary. So we now have a denominational seminary that we have a co-op with, not a co-op, together with the Dutch
partnership. With and he was in what role with the seminary?
He was the president.
President, and then they're seeking a building right now.
But again, a lot of what our day to day work involves is working with first generation believers. No transfer growth really to speak of. It's mostly first generation believers. I use this picture because this couple, Lena and Andrea, were both orphans growing up, and Anya Plachkova met them, invited them from the orphanage to come to our church for a VBS, and they continued to come. They grew up, fell in love, and she said on this day of her wedding, she was so happy that her family, her church family, because that is her family, could be present. And now they have
two little kids,
and it's just beautiful to see their picture of the Ukrainian church growing and expanding and having first generation families.
Lena now comes, well, she did just before we left the field. I was hosting and facilitating a young moms. It was kind of a Bible study / play date for their kids. And so the young moms would come with their kids, probably ages, I don't know, a year to about 7 years. And sometimes that worked well and sometimes that didn't. But we got some Bible study in there and prayed for one another. And it was interesting to hear just each time Lana would come and talk about her desire to walk more closely with God and some of the things, just struggles that come up in daily life as a mom.
And we work with these new believers, as I said earlier, to help them learn what evangelism is, first of all, through everyday life. What does it look like when you're out in the market or in the store and you see the same people every day? You know, we don't have a car. We have bikes or we walk. And so you only buy as much as you can carry.
So you go pretty often.
So you go often. You're out every single day. You're passing the same people. You're buying from the same people. How do you take that relationship a step further? And it's hard for us. It's hard for you. You know, wherever you are, to go past just casual acquaintance.
The niceties about the weather and what happened on I-85 or something like that.
What does it look like in your community? We live in a community that just avails itself to the gospel. You know, and right now we're in Lawrenceville, Georgia, and I can understand how difficult it is for you to share the gospel.
In America.
In the suburbs, you never see your neighbors. It's you pull up and go into your home.
They drive into their garage door opener, and they go inside, and you see them maybe if they work in their yard on the weekend, but you may be out taking your kids to soccer or something like that. So it's very difficult to have that time.
Where we live,
unless you initiate it.
Again, you're out all the time. We have these courtyards in Odessa.
We live in an apartment.
We live in an apartment, and you get to know all your neighbors.
Whether you like to or not.
Yeah. Especially in the summertime, your windows are open, and you get to smell everything that's being made for everyone's dinner. Mm-hmm. You get to hear every conversation and every argument. Mm-hmm. You get to hear everyone's music. Mm-hmm. You are living in community. It's absolute community.
Yeah. Can't escape.
And here's the... You know, a couple times a year, all the ladies drag their carpets out into the courtyard, and they hose them down, and they wash them, and they all help each other. But how do you take those relationships to the next level as far as sharing the gospel? And not just making them targets, but loving them, investing in them, getting to know them. How do you do that? We help them to understand evangelism through everyday life, but also through using their passions and their gifts. One of the easiest gifts that we have been given is speaking
the English language.
And we are able to have weekly classes with people in the community or with university students. We have a yearly evangelical English camp that draws in about 60 people. We spend a week going deeper and deeper with them. Mm-hmm. We
get to have good discussion group times with them around tables about worldview, just challenging where their thinking is heading, or how they react to certain controversies in our daily life, things like that, in their government and their country and our country. So it's very interesting to get into those discussions.
We have we use our passions, not just our gifts, our abilities. We use our passions. Our girls have used their singing and acting skills to interact with other schools, other students.
They tutor in Russian as well, so they have to do a lot of this in Russian.
I enjoy, as many of you know, photography, so we are able to use that on March 8th, which is a huge holiday. It's Women's Day. All the women are all dressed up, so we go out with people in our church, and we'll give some of the ladies who are all dressed up some flowers and some chocolate and an invitation to come to the church and take their picture and say, you can get your free picture by going to this website. And on the website, we have information about the church and what time we serve and what we're all about. But it's just using things that we naturally like to do mm-hmm. as a way to meet people, to engage people. We do the same thing at Halloween. Halloween is not the same there as it is here. They don't go trick-or-treating, but all the young people meet in the center of the city. So we do,
dressed
too.
Dressed up very ghoulishly.
Yeah, it's more like The Walking Dead. But we went out there and took their pictures and gave them candy and gave them tracks and talked to them about the reality of what happens when you die. Mm-hmm.
And the spiritual world and realm.
You know, and that's not to say you can't do it here as well. We actually...
We were here in the States this Halloween for the first time in 4 years, 5 years.
So we thought, let's do the same thing. Mm-hmm. So we gave out little flyers to everyone in our neighborhood, and we had Halloweenies. We grilled some hot dogs and had a fire pit.
Fire pit with chips, salsa, and drinks.
I think it was like 75 degrees.
But yeah, it was kind of funny here in Georgia.
And all of our neighbors, a lot of them, came down. It was just a time to get to know them, tell them who we are, what we're about. You can even take an opportunity and say, you know what, we have a prayer ministry. If you ever need prayer for anything, if you're ever going through a difficult thing, come on down. We'd love to talk with you about it. And just avail yourself to them. Yeah. Andrea loves to cook. And
eat.
And I love to eat.
Right.
So we...
I would take women, some from the church also, like he was saying, trying to incorporate people that are believers on these ministries, but allowing them to interact with other people that we'd met in the community or through the English club that were not yet coming to the church. And just cooking a menu with them. This, in this case, it's pizza. But the women all work together. They work on the recipes together in my kitchen, my little kitchen there. And then we eat them all together around a table and talk. And it's a wonderful time for them to see who we are and for us to, like Bob said, just let them know that we're in the community, what we're available for. I had mentioned that I work with young moms, and that's been a more recent addition. Right before we left, I was able to go through the book of Ephesians with a bunch of moms. But a lot of that time is also taking care of little kids running around.
That particular picture, actually, she's not in the group, but she's visiting. Yeah, but it shows what she does.
Yeah, we do a lot of hosting, actually. So she was passing through from a different country, and she was a former friend from that church in Odessa, but had moved away. And so when she came back in, she stayed at our house.
You know, the hosting is absolutely part of the ministry too, because, mm-hmm. you know, we had someone tell us one time, you know, your seminars are great, your teaching's great, Bible studies, I get a lot from them, but honestly, a lot of that I forget over time. What I seem to remember is when I'm in your home and I see you doing certain things, and they give examples of how we deal with Abigail when she was especially younger, mm-hmm. or even older, you know, how we discipline or how we love our kids or love each other, mm-hmm. or living a Christ-centered life. It stands out in this culture much more as a contrast. Mm-hmm. So that's a big part. So we show them evangelism through everyday life, through passions and gifts. And the biggest ministry, I would say, is through meeting needs in the community. We want to have churches that if they were ever to have to close their doors, that the whole community would mourn, because we're so engaged in meeting the needs of the community and loving them and helping them. And there are many, many, many needs. And
yeah, I mean, Ukraine. just Bob mentioned earlier, the refugees that are flooding in from the east of Ukraine, you know, as a result of that conflict with Russia. How many, honey, did you say?
2 million.
2 million people displaced. The homes have either been decimated or they've lost their livelihood there and can't provide, so they come over toward the middle and toward the west of Ukraine, if they stay in Ukraine, that is. And we have a counseling center.
I'll talk about that in a second. Right now, just letting you know some of the needs that are out there. as a ratio, alcoholism, drug use, and depression, about 5 times higher than the U.S. That's throughout post-Soviet countries. That's Russia, Ukraine. Andrew talked about the 2 million refugees from the fighting in eastern Ukraine. There's a growing population of people suffering, especially from those regions, from post-traumatic stress disorder. And the highest HIV and tuberculosis rates, not only in Europe, but also in Russia. There is a lower life expectancy, poor access to good healthcare, high abortion rate, high corruption rates, high poverty rates. Because of, it used to be Moldova, but because of the conflict now with Russia, it is considered the poorest nation in Europe.
And they're not allowed to be a part of the EU either.
Right. And I say all this just to say, when you look into in the community, you don't have to look very far to see how can I meet needs of people. There are plenty of opportunities. We walk outside of our door, and on a regular basis, there are men, homeless people, sleeping on the stoop just a couple of feet from our door.
Often they're drunk as well.
Often. There is many of you are aware of the trafficking issues. You have a combination of very attractive people and very poor nation, and you have other nations that want to take advantage of that. And so you have trafficking issues. You have many of the women are drawn into trafficking. Some of them are not aware of what they're getting into.
It's a scam. Some sort.
Some are scammed into it. Some don't see any other options and get drawn into it. We would love to see a ministry starting with that soon. I went to a funeral not too long ago, and this is a picture I took. It's a stark picture of the cemetery. A lot of fresh graves. It's a large city. Odessa is about 1 million people, but still, even for that, it seemed like there were many fresh graves. And as I walked around these graves, many of them were in their 20s, early 30s, teens, but you had a lot of people dying young. So it's a hurting nation. Mm-hmm. Now, in order to meet those needs, we have started some ministries, but most of what we do now is helping Ukrainians who have a passion for their community, helping them to realize ways to fulfill what God's called them to do. We have a counselor from Birmingham, Langston Haygood, who has come over multiple times to train counselors. He worked in the university system. He worked with local counselors and groups to provide training for them to help people and help other Ukrainians. We've also brought over a trained counselor from Britain to train them in PTSD to help those refugees.
And one of our own congregation members started a counseling center as a result of that.
Liana Kolker.
Right. So Liana's counseling center has continued to reach out to refugee centers, places where they're gathering, especially invalids, elderly, where they cannot get regular help. She goes with her other counselors. They bring humanitarian aid, sometimes medicine, and counseling for PTSD.
So we find ourselves moving out of a leading role and more into a supportive role, which is, praise God, absolutely what we want.
You're also in an advisement role. Works on the board of several of these different ministries. He's about to talk with you about the Crisis Pregnancy Center we have in Ismail, and has served on that board since its inception, about
12
right?
years.
Yeah, so it's exciting to see them taking the lead with their passions, but we're still able to support from under or from around, not necessarily financially, but more in this situation. They've got their funding. They have what they need, but just advising,
right.
Business sense, and decisions for strategy.
The Crisis Pregnancy Center is run by wonderful lady named Snezhana Popova, and I'll have a link so you can check out her site. Mm-hmm. It's one of the best ministries in Ukraine, I believe, because it, like I said, there's a high abortion rate. It's coming down from when we first got to Ukraine, but it's still very high, and you have a lot of young families that are afraid, or single women who are afraid, and they offer help to them. They teach them what their pregnancy is about. They counsel women who are considering abortions. Mm-hmm. As part of their plan, if they go through all their classes, then they are given clothing and even a crib at the end of their time. I give them a photo session for them and their family to celebrate the new life happening. But they're also the only group in Ismail that is able to go into the public school and university system and teach about abstinence and how God views sexuality. And we have a guy named Larry Love. He's a gynecologist from Tennessee who comes over regularly to teach in these university settings.
Yeah, it gives some pretty big examples and stark statistics about STDs and how common those are and what those do to your body. But oftentimes, anybody with any kind of a birth defect, with any kind of a disorder, especially one like autism that's not known as much over there, diagnosed as easily, they are marginalized. These people are hidden away. They're an embarrassment. Their families are just without resources. They don't know what to do to help. There are some orphanages that take kids that are with different challenges, but it's almost like you set them aside in a home because you don't know how to take care of them yourself. And in many cases, they just needed the education and resources to know what they're dealing with and how to go about it. So we were really privileged to have a doctor from Birmingham that would Skype through, mm-hmm. and talk with care workers and parents, answering their questions in real time, giving them resources and advice for what we have done in the States, what we've seen work with these groups in the States.
We were trying to raise up a new generation, and when I say we, our churches are trying to raise up a new generation. And so we have a day school, a Christian day school called Dawn, and every year they are just operating on a shoestring budget, barely making it by, but they've continued year after year. I applaud their efforts.
So far, it's only K through four. Mm-hmm. They would love to expand that, but like Bob said, they need funding as well to really survive.
One of our first ministries was a medical clinic that was started in Belgrade, started by one of our pastors who was also a pathologist. And he had a desire to start a clinic that would treat people with dignity and not require bribes and treat them with excellence. And so we were able to, our teams were able to help that get going.
I think all of our ministries are striving for that, to treat people with dignity and excellence.
One of our, my biggest things right now is joys and privileges is working with Pastor George Kadyan. He is the pastor of our church plant in the north of
Covenant
Odessa.
Of Grace.
Covenant of Grace. And this man and his family are just some of our favorite people in Ukraine. They have a huge heart for God and for his people and for the lost. And they are currently meeting in this building. We're renting it, but we're trying to raise funds to purchase it. This building will ultimately, the first floor will be a worship center. The second floor will be an outreach. He wants to have an outreach to the youth in the community to help them.
Especially teens.
Help them have the tools they need to succeed in life. Mm-hmm. And currently he's living on the first floor. And I said, George, if you do that, where are you going to live? And he said, well, we can live in the garage. You see on the left side of that, there's a little garage. And I said, your whole family's going to live in a one-car garage? And he said, yeah, we can retrofit it a little bit and do some renovations and make it work. And I was really moved by that. I thought, that's a passion. That's a passion to use everything that God has given you for his glory. Mm-hmm. And
so we'd like to continue to raise funds, not only for the building, but also to give some renovations to that garage so that they can move in there and free up the building wholly for that ministry that they have a real vision for.
And our goal as a team, as a Ukraine MTW team, is to see churches begun in each of the different oblasts, the counties, if you will, of Ukraine. We're only in about maybe a fourth of them right now. And we'd like to see that spread to where we have anchor churches in each one of those. But beyond that, we'd love to see as people go, whether it's through hardship or through, you know, planning to go, we'd love to see the church expand into Europe and into Russia and the Baltics.
Places where Americans as missionaries can't really go, but Ukrainians can. They have that access. They have those connections.
We find this is a very strategic time for all of Europe. There's a lot happening. People are questioning spiritual things for different reasons, because of refugees or because of whatever reason. And Ukrainians are able to go into these communities, especially into Russia, a lot mm-hmm. more readily than we are. Mm-hmm. So we are, as Andrew said, we're excited about seeing the church expanding. But we do believe that spiritually, Ukraine is a very strategic place right now. It's a light. It's a light in a dark place. It's a place that we love. We call home now. But it is spiritually a dark place.
Yeah, and the gospel needs to shine forth from that. We really believe that these churches that we're working with will be that beacon of light and spread God's word.
Yeah. If you want to learn more about us, if you want to see what's going on with us, you can always go to our blog, www.burnhamsnapshots.com/blog. And on there, you can sign up to be notified when we have our regular updates. We have we try every 4 to 6 weeks put out something that lets you know how to pray, what's going on, stories, maybe a video. And that's about it. We're going to continue to put things out. This is a whole lot more than 30 minutes, so thanks for your patience. But we are going to be returning. We're on home ministry assignment right now. We'll be returning to Ukraine in late July, early August. It depends on when we have our funds come in. So we still have funds to raise. If you are interested in supporting this ministry, give me a call. There's my number right there. And right underneath it is our email address. But you can write to us if you're interested in supporting us or talking
to us. Or if your church is. Yeah.
Or talk to your church. Mm-hmm. If you're not able to, but your church might be interested in helping us out, we'd love that. Mm-hmm. We'd love to come and meet with you or your pastor or your missions committee. So that's about it for now. Andrea?
That could have been bad.
That could have been bad. It'd be a bad omen. Not that we believe in.
All right. Thank you for your patience and your attention.
All right. We'll see you guys later.
Have a good day. Bye-bye.